distinguished speakers and guests, welcome to the Blue Circle. For those of you who are new with us today, the Blue Circle is an exclusive ecosystem and network for industry leaders to help them manage today's VUCA world and become future ready by learning from each other and through hand-picked experts that we bring in. And to serve our members comprehensively, we have created a six-pronged ecosystem, which is seminars, industry-focused roundtables, a media publication platform featuring featuring industry leaders and their stories, an expert panel of industry leaders who can advise you and your organizations, access to our partner communities world over, research and other resources. I warmly thank you all for being here today. We have striven to ensure that this evening, like every other Blue Circle evening, is worth your while. Voltaire said, "Work protects you from boredom, vice, and need." Work is a very important part of one's life. The nature of work is changing. The nature of workers is changing. And the complexion of the workplace is changing. Any picture of how the workforce is changing will be complete only when seeing through all these lenses simultaneously, and when it takes into account the technological, the demographic, the psychographic, and environmental changes that affect it. Once again, we have a panel which is handpicked to provide a distilled and well-considered perspective on this topic of discussion. Let me now not come between you and the panel, and I would request them to please come on stage. Ms. Ira Gupta is heading HR for Microsoft India. She joined Microsoft in October 2012 and is responsible for leading HR priorities and developing HR initiatives that support Microsoft's businesses across India and across its 7,000 strong employee base. Prior to Microsoft, Ira spent 16 years at GlaxoSmithKline Consumer Healthcare in various roles across multiple functions. Post receiving her postgraduate diploma from XLRI Jamshedpur in 1997, she joined GSK India in HR, moved to sales and marketing, and later established the communications and CSR function for GSK. She subsequently moved back to HR to work on areas relating to talent management, strategy, compensation and benefits, and shared services across businesses. She was also a member of the Indian leadership team. She has extensive experience across leadership and organizational development, talent management, leading change, business partnership and rewards. She has led large-scale organizational change products, including setting up HR shared services across countries and business units. Ms. Rachna Bhanot is client HR leader, India domestic businesses at IBM India. Earlier, she has led the HR Cloud and Systems Software Portfolio, Asia Pacific at IBM Singapore, and Associate Director HR Relations Case Management. A seasoned HR professional with 29 years of work experience, Rachna is known for successfully partnering and coaching executives for human talent transformation and organizational effectiveness. She has done her economic honors from LSR, Delhi, and masters from International Management Institute. Mr. Rajeev Dubey is the Group President, HR and Corporate Services and CEO Aftermarket Sector for Mahindra & Mahindra Group. He joined Mahindra & Mahindra in January 2004 after a career spanning 29 years in the Tata Group, of which 7 years was MD and CEO first of Tata Metallics and then of Rallis India. Rajeev sits on several boards, including Group Management Board of Mahindra & Mahindra and several of its group companies, International Organization of Employers and International Labor Organization, Geneva, and ILO's International Training Center in Turin, Italy. He is also professionally associated with a number of prestigious institutes and committees such as CII, HRD, LBSIM, and Walchin Talent First Limited. He studied economics at St. Stephen's and at the Delhi School of Economics, did his MBA from Yale School of Management, USA, and was selected as a distinguished alumnus of the school. Mr. Pavan Choudary is the author of critically acclaimed bestsellers like How Good Person Can Really Win, When You're Sinking Become a Submarine, a trilogy of wisdom on Chanakya, Confucius and Kabir, and Machiavelli for Moral People. He has also co-authored path-breaking books with Kiran Bedi and Anil Shastri. He also hosts the TV program Hum Aise Kyun Hain and has written columns for Times of India and Financial Chronicle. In the last, he has also been awarded as the Intellectual Icon of the Year and the Global Leadership Award by Bharatiya Vidya Peet and the Eric Hoffer Award for Nonfiction. He is currently the CEO of Vygon India, a French multinational, Trustee Lal Bahadur Shastri, Trustee Bharatiya Vidya Niti, Chairman, Medical Technology Association of India, Independent Director, Transasia Biomedicals, an Advisory Board Member, Executive Access and Wisdom Angels, the PE Fund. Pavan is now also known for The Deep Slice, a series of two-minute video nuggets which carries eye-opening insights for advanced leaders. He coaches several leaders on business and life. Please note that we shall have time for Q&A towards the end of the session. And I now hand over the mic to Mr. Choudary to take the session forward, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, Siddharth. And welcome, everybody. It's a great pleasure to have you. And it's an equally great pleasure to have such a fine panel here. Before we start, let me just briefly set the context by starting from how society has looked at work. So as per Christian doctrine, work was punishment, because Adam, when he plucked the apple and ate it, God condemned him that from your sweat of your brow, you will eat now for 930 years. So work was punishment at that time. During Aristotelian times, also, work was supposed to be, Aristotle said, that a person who has to earn to live by working is a slave. This view remained till Renaissance and the Industrial Revolution. Perhaps because of the Industrial Revolution's social needs, a new view started emerging at that time, which was work should be remunerative and also creative. And that has been the view which has grown. Now work should be remunerative, creative, fulfilling, and it should also provide you status. This is the ideal view of work. The reality may be a little different, because when you Google the word work, the most popular synonym is drudgery. When you Google the word employee, the most popular synonym is slave. And when you Google the word boss, the most popular synonym is slave driver. And second most popular synonym is zookeeper. But having said that, I do agree with what Siddharth said, that work in the large part keeps vice, need and boredom at bay. This is where we are. Now, where are we going? So there are two paths which are emerging. One is the utopian view and the other is the dystopian view. The utopian view of work is saying that there will be techno unemployment. The utopian view is saying that there will be greater inclusion, wages for everybody, time for leisure and culture, where your computers and robots will do the heavy lifting. This is the utopian view. The dystopian view is saying that work will not be available for everybody. There will be high unemployment, there will be great inequality. So these are the two views, and we have a very select panel here. And I would like to begin with Rajeev. Rajeev, can you tell us which of these views broadly you endorse?
Just to make the conversation interesting, let me take an extreme view. But there's no point in saying it will be somewhere in the middle, because that's
my job.
That's your job. I think there's a real risk and a real danger that the dystopian view will prevail. that there will not be enough jobs to go around, that the inequality, which has been increasing, by the way, the Gini coefficient, which is a measure of inequality, has been becoming higher and higher everywhere. Real wages per capita have been falling. We are a charmed circle, you see, so we are a little protected from the harsh realities of life. For that, maybe you have to go into the jungles of Bastar to see what it means not to have a job. But that, I am afraid, is the real risk we run unless very proactively we do things to counter that. If we don't focus on creating jobs, if we don't believe that organizations and nations cannot be competitive in the long run unless they are at the same time fair and inclusive. If that paradigm does not prevail, and if we do not proactively look at what are the skills and competencies to be created, how do people who don't have money get the skills and competencies which will be required to get the new jobs, and technology will pervade everything, whether we like it or not. What will happen to social security? Who will be there for dispute resolution? You know, the entire paradigm on which the entire governance and the entire philosophies which guide present day rules of working are changing. In India, of course, none of these rules apply except to a small lot of people like you and me, the 7% who are in the so-called organized or the formal sector. So India already knows what it means to have inequality and to have poverty and filth and squalor. And if we are not really careful, I'm afraid things are going to become worse. So here I have stuck my neck out so that the others can chop it off.
That's really wonderful. So wonderful. So Ira, come with your axe, please, with the utopian view.
So see, every time that there's been a big change in technology, I'm sorry, my voice is really bad, you'll have to excuse me. Every time there's been a major technological change, people have prophesied to either side of the spectrum. You know, when there was nuclear power, people said either there'll be power for everybody or there'll be mass destruction. You know, when there was genomics, people either said that there would be solutions for every illness, or they said again that there will be bioweaponry, correct? And now people are saying either, as you said, that there will be just leisure or there will be robots which take over our lives. And I just feel somehow that I'm a bit of an optimist and I'm a bit of a moderate sort of person. And when I look, not 100 years down, but if I look a couple of decades down, I really feel that in many ways the future is already here and it isn't that scary, you know. And I've seen data from McKinsey which says that with AI, with automation, with data technologies and so on an average by 2030, 15% of jobs will be sort of shift. There will be an impact on 15% of what they call job activities, right? Across the world, that's the average. The highest is in countries like Germany, where it's about 30 to 33%. But for India, it's 9% in the next 11 years. So I'm a little bit more of an optimist. I also feel that if you even look at when, you know, horse-drawn carriages were replaced by automobiles, there were so many jobs which went for people involved with building and driving horse-drawn carriages, but oil and natural gas increased, manufacturing increased, advertising increased. There was a set of ancillary industry which came up. And so I think with change is going to come opportunity. But as Rajeev said, I think it's going to be up to us to see how we embrace it in advance to ready for it.
So do you agree with that, Rajeev? With change will come opportunity? Or your point is we have to divide when the opportunity will come, whether it is going to come in the next 10 years, 50 years, or in the first 50 years, there is going to be risk and mayhem. So what's your view?
No, so with every change, of course, opportunity comes, but challenges also come. I think that to go into a situation without being aware of both the opportunities as well as the challenges, we are being a little foolish. All that I'm saying is, let us be aware that there are grave challenges. Let us use the power and the miracles of technology to solve carefully identified problems. What are we going to use technology for? Technology will be like the 10 numerals from 0 to 9 and the 26 alphabets of the English language or whatever language you choose, which can be used for anything. We can use it to create bombs that destroy people. We can use it to solve the mysteries of disease and hunger. So what do we use technology for? What do we focus it on is going to be very crucial. And what I'm saying is that there are real problems that are there, and can we use technology to solve the real problems which will vary from society to society? And therefore, for us in India, we have to be very mindful which problems we will focus technology on to solve. And I'm suggesting that we should use it to solve basic problems of hunger, poverty, disease, water, governance in our rural areas. If we focus there, in that, I'm not saying that, you know, corporations should not use technology, but just corporations using technology and the rest of society not using technology to solve basic problems will land us into a mess. That's what I'm saying. Right. So I'm just taking a macro.
So bringing you in, Rachna, do you agree with what Ira has said? That so far all the technology big curves have come have only meant greater employment, etc. Or you feel this time that the curve which is coming is going to be different? This time the bump is different or similar?
So I am a bit of a balancing act kind of a person, right? So I do think that the different strata of society, different segments of society will get impacted differently. So if we look at, you know, the 7% that Rajeev talked about earlier, that is going to get impacted in a very, very positive, and I mean, again, it's going to be opportunity as well as challenge there. And there is going to be augmented, change, and with AI and other things coming in from a technology perspective. On the other hand, change in its positive sense will also percolate down to what we call the rural areas and the deprived, as Rajeev talked about. I'll take a small example. Yesterday, we did not think that telecom would have the impact it's having today. So if you look at what's happened to mobile, the biggest users of technology, mobile technology, does not lie only in the corporate or the have society. It is the have-nots who are actually leveraging that phenomenally. So I think it's a combination of the two, and there's going to be a different impact in different segments.
So in other words, you're saying that technology will substitute some tasks of the job.
Absolutely.
It will also augment and enrich some tasks of the job.
Absolutely.
And it will also create new jobs. This is what you're saying.
Absolutely.
What, yeah, your point?
Yeah, so since I'm being contrarian today, might as well do a good job of it.
Do it. Right. I'm going to come and help you.
Okay. So do you know, after the Industrial Revolution, how many years it took for the per capita income in England to start rising? The real per capita income? 100 years.
Oh.
Okay, now I'm not saying that it will take, but it, for us to think that in the transition period there won't be huge problems, I think is wishful thinking. Yes, McKinsey has this report, you know, may it be true. McKinsey isn't always correct. But it won't happen on its own. That's what I'm saying, that we have to have really directed action taken to make sure that the have-nots get some benefits of the rub-off of technology. And that is my real, because it's going to just increase the inequality. Jobs will be there only for the very educated and the very skilled. You can't get education unless you have money. So then what happens to the poor people? They become poor, and that's exactly what's happening. Look at what is, you know, I'm using that word Gini coefficient.
Yeah, yeah.
That's just, I mean, there are many economists sitting in the audience and on the stage. That's just becoming bigger and bigger. The United States. And all the stuff that we are seeing, all these revolutions and the Trump coming, they are expressions of the rising inequality and the have-nots in their own way raising their voice. And the Naxalite movement, the Bastar, what are all these things? People finally saying enough is enough. We don't want all the income to be and the wealth to be in the hands of seven people.
Yeah. In fact, you're right. Eight people have as much wealth as 50% of the population of the world. So, paraphrasing what Rajeev has said and bringing it to Ira. One is, he's saying McKinsey has said something, But then there are other studies also like OECD, etc., which are going quite different, and Brugler, which is even more different from the one which you have quoted. The other one is, Ira, man has been at the forefront of all the cusps which came because he could learn, think and adapt. But now machines are also coming which can learn, think and adapt. So won't this time be different? And lastly, you mentioned Germany. Germany may have 35% unemployment. But because today Germany and rest of the world is connected with India and rest of the world, do you not think that this globalization which connects us, which will prey upon those countries also, jobs there also, because productivity and profits are linked. And if they are losing jobs there, it will mean that here also competition will increase. What do you think?
I'm certainly more of an optimist.
Good.
I think there is definitely the role of conscience. When huge changes occur, especially the kind of changes today, there has to be social conscience. There has to be principled decision making. You cannot work in a context of such rapid technological changes if you are not incredibly mindful of the social, economic, cultural, societal impact that technological change is creating. But if you choose to be inclusive, and just what I'm seeing in organizations around the world, what I'm seeing in governments around the world, apart from a few which are becoming incredibly nationalist, is there is democratization of technology, which is intentional. There is an intentional effort to make technology inclusive and available in order to transform societies. Correct? Even if you look at my own organization, right? In Microsoft, we say that our vision is to empower every person and every organization on the planet to do more. It's an incredibly inclusive vision. Mahindra and Mahindra has an incredibly inclusive vision, right? The reason that we exist has all, companies have become much more society conscious and much more conscious of their own obligations. Millennial generation, which is entering the workforce, close to 50% of them want to work with a company which has a greater cause than its own. So I think the world is moving in that direction. So my hope is that along with that, technology will take more people along. And you know, more jobs are going to get created in different places. So for example, the anticipation is the construction industry. Infrastructure, buildings, roads, all of that is going to create huge employment. A lot of in aging societies, healthcare is going to create huge employment. Nursing is going to create huge employment. It's interesting, education, teachers. So different kinds of things are going to come up. Agrarian workers are going to start increasingly migrating. As a growing middle class gets created in countries like ours, with our growing consumerism, there is going to be some level of creation of roles and jobs at work which didn't exist today. In fact, I read this very interesting thing just the other day in another context, where in the 1960s, Lyndon Johnson in America commissioned a panel to look at the impact on the economy of change at the time. And the conclusion of the panel was, technology will destroy jobs, it will not destroy work.
Yeah. Okay. So I think now let us take this question for the time being to the audience. There are two very well argued points coming up here. One is coming from Rajeev. Rajeev also chairs the ILO governing body.
No, just a member.
Member of the. And he is saying that there is going to be a dystopic vision, the problems are coming. And the challenges may outweigh the opportunities for the time being, at least. This is what he's saying. And what Ira is saying, Ira, as you know, heads Microsoft HR. What she is saying is that there are going to be more opportunities and things will move towards greater prosperity, inclusiveness and job growth, etc. What does the audience say? Who are on Rajiv's side and who are on Ira's side? Rajiv's side, raise your hand, please. Rajiv's side. One, two, three, four. Okay. And Ira's side? Okay, so I think it's a tie. So we move forward to the next question, which is, how is workforce and worker going to change? I think the whole panel agrees that change is coming. So how is the workforce and worker going to change? Let's start with you, Rachna.
All right. So first of all, I think, the way we're looking at work in itself is going to change. It's not just change, it's actually now transformation. It's disruptive, right? We talked about, some jobs getting incepted, some jobs changing, some jobs disappearing, but something or the other, as we, reskill, upskill ourselves, keeps coming back, and we will have opportunity to have work which is productive. Let me come to the workforce itself. Workforce is going to see another disruption. I wouldn't be wrong if I was to suggest that there's going to be some sort of an uberization of the workforce. So let's take an example. It's almost like instead of coming to work in a particular place, skills are going to be really important. Our investments in learning and skills for a particular kind of job are going to become more and more important. A team comes together, produces a movie. One is a producer, another one is a cameraman, a third one is probably a color specialist, the fourth one is on design, a fifth one does something else, and some are artists. They all come together, they produce a movie, and they disseminate, go back. They may not work again together. So that's a big disruption. And I expect that a very similar thing is going to happen as far as our workforce is concerned, right? So that's my view on the workforce angle. That doesn't take away the fact that, there will be some amount of consistency in terms of the current workforce metamorphizing itself to the new age skills, the new ways of working. Now, let me come to the third part of it. We're talking about workspaces. I see workspaces metamorphizing and changing in two ways. One, I would say that, workspaces themselves will become extremely AI enabled. They would be almost cognitive. They would be giving you nudges. Okay, you booked a meeting room. And we're already doing that actually in some of our offices now. You booked a meeting room, and it's 5 minutes past your meeting time. It will quickly give you a nudge before the time is over, after the time is over. It will also tell you, so-and-so is sitting in such and such seat. So there's there's a lot of mobility. It's not going to be like constant. You come to work, this is my desk, this is my seat, this is where I keep my things. It's nothing like that. It's all like very agile, very, very different. The second part that I see is that there is going to be no workspace. All right. Now, this is a very disruptive part. But let me share with you something that, came to my site a couple of days back. Now, we were in a very critical project with a customer. And this customer wanted to speak to the person who was the digital architect for that particular business line. We tried in vain to get it in touch with the person multiple times. Finally, we got across to the person. The customer insisted he wants a video call so that he can actually talk to the individual and see the individual and understand the perspective. So we got across to this particular specialist. The specialist happened to be in Ladakh, in the mountains, sitting on a yak, Y-A-K, headphones on, phone in front of him, iPad actually in front of him, and he's taking a call from there and solutioning a customer challenge. And this is reality. We just experienced it a few weeks back. So what is the relevance of workspace anymore? I see workspace actually metamorphizing that way. You could be sitting on the beaches of Goa, you could be somewhere like across the world. As long as you are connected, you are in a virtual team environment, and you know that what you bring to the table from a technology, from a business sense perspective, and you can solution your customer problems to delight the customer, the workspace becomes irrelevant.
Well, so I think what you're saying is this: finally, even if we could not be the Shah Rukh Khans or the Javed Akhtars of Bollywood, you wanted to be a theater. You are already a theater artist.
But not
we can at least aspire to work like them, coming together on a project and then disseminating. So that's great. And what do you think, Rajeev? Okay. What would you like to add to this?
Sure. Okay. So I have a few things to add. I think that the two characteristics of work which will stand out for me, and I immediately wonder whether I am making a statement that may apply only to a small part and not to every aspect of work in a country like India. But definitely, I think wherever we are, there will be more and more of human-machine interaction, right? Or technology-human interaction. So that's going to happen no matter where we are. Even in rural India, that's going to happen. I think in many places, work will be problem-solving and managing human relationships. Now, that may sound a little paradoxical because we talk so much about technology, but actually the management of human relationships will become more and more important in work. In the workforce, what I think will happen, there'll be a very wide spectrum of the worker types and worker work arrangements. So you'll have in any one organization some permanent people, some outsourced people, some on contract, some gig workers, maybe some crowd workers, and the kind of skills that they bring, the kind of contractual arrangements that have to be managed, and the complexity of putting them all together to produce an ecosystem which is competitive, innovative, collaborative will be huge. And finally, of course, from the point of view of the workplace, I think there'll be issues. There'll be not so much of co-location, but there would be in some kinds of work dispersion. But I'm just thinking that when you're going to produce in the manufacturing sector, you still need a fair amount of co-location, right? So maybe the support functions in a manufacturing setup would have the kind of things that you're saying. But for example, to produce a car, you probably would need some kind of co-location. So again, there'll be a spectrum. And I think that is the real complexity of the ecosystem of work, workforce, and workplace. That there'll be many, many kinds, and they have to be managed in such a way that put together, they produce innovation, competition, and the role of human beings, the role of relationships, the role of emotions, the role of collaboration, the role of culture, the role of values, the role of meaning, the role of passion, far from becoming less, will actually need to be more. Now, that's the contrarian stand I want to take.
No, that's a very one. In fact, I was thinking the designation of Chief Human Resource Officer can be changed to make it Chief Human and Machine Resource Officer, because that machine and humans are going to come and play together, as you said. That's great. Coming to you, Ira. Recently, I read Accenture, which is also a company like yours, is working at the cutting edge of technology, business, and society. It has brought much more tolerant HR policy. For example, even LGBTs, their partners are also covered through insurance. They've gone even to the extent that gender reassignment surgery also will be covered. Do you think that this tolerance is also increasing? And is it difficult for the baby boomers who were born in the 60s to handle this? Do they find it too stark or unpalatable? What is your view?
I like deep. Swear.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay. I do use data when I think through stuff like this. And there is data which says that organizations which are inclusive have 20% less turnover and 12% more effort being made by the average employee just because the culture is one of inclusion, right? I think the world needs to become far more accepting of the diversity that exists for various reasons which talk to human values, various reasons which are practical, because you just are going to have a huge skill shortage, right? But also because every person brings their own perspective, which unless you have been in that situation, you don't understand. And I'll give you an example. Microsoft has this very large diversity and inclusion conference every year, which we just finished last week in Hyderabad. And we had a head of research there, and I asked him, I said, products that we are making for inclusion, and what have you learned about it? And he said this to me. He said, you know, I hired someone who's visually impaired into my research team. And he says, one of the first things he said is, one of your products is Visual Studio. The word visual itself is not inclusive.
Well,
right? So organizations need to be able to bring inclusion into everything that they do, every bit of their work, so that when we even create products, when we think about how to market those products, when we think about making those products relevant, you're actually being as inclusive in design and outreach as possible. If organizations like us don't invite people of different dimensions in, then we are really doing a disservice at a very fundamental level, right? So I think most organizations, we do gender reassignment surgery, we pick up the cost. We have for a long time covered same-sex partners on health insurance. We cover a lot of disability, people with disability, incredibly powerful community, correct? We do bereavement leave because different people are at different stages. You know, if there's a death in the family, then you do need more time off. And there are enough people, baby boomers, who need that, right? So there's a whole bunch of things that all organizations today are doing. But to answer your question, I don't think anyone is against it.
Okay.
I don't think that, because we are learning from our children. Mm. And our children are very much more open, perhaps, than the generation that came before us. And so it's...
What? Your view, Rajeev? Sorry, if I may just add something.
Please.
You know, I think innovation is going to be at the core of an individual or an organization or a country to survive and prosper. Innovation is possible only when you bring lot of diversity of thinking. Even in the old, we were discussing Marxism, right? Mm-hmm. I'm a pseudo-Marxist, false Marxist, not a true one.
Mm-hmm.
There also it was thesis, antithesis leading to synthesis. In nature, when opposites combine, you produce something which is more powerful. And therefore, for innovation, you need to embrace the power of diversity. So it's not only because philosophically and morally it's a nice thing to do, which is good enough to do it, by the way, but it makes damn good business sense to embrace the power of diversity and the power of inclusion. And one more reason, and I want to add, now this is from a societal point of view, the new normal in which we are operating, mostly we talk about VUCA. That's the common way of, it's not only VUCA, it's VUCA plus pushback. I think all stakeholders, whether it's consumers, employees, members of the supply chain, the communities, the shareholders, of course, the communities in which we operate are not going to lie back and take what we give to them. There will be a pushback. And one of the ways, or perhaps the only way, to take care of a pushback is to include. Therefore, I think, and I'm repeating myself, you cannot be competitive on a sustained basis. You cannot show sustained outperformance unless, in addition to whatever you may do on the pure efficiency and effectiveness side and technology side, you are fair and inclusive with respect to the ecosystem. So it, I think, is going to be a complete, practical, business necessity to be fair and inclusive if you want to be competitive. I'm sticking my neck out and I'm making
very good point.
Can I say something?
Yeah, go ahead. Go.
It's actually a world-class example that I just want to share with this group. Again, at conference on Friday when we were in Hyderabad, our keynote speaker was a lady called Haben Girma. She's an African-American lady, young girl. She's the first blind, deaf graduate of Harvard Law School. Her mother came to America as a refugee from Sudan. And today, she was the keynote speaker on Friday because it was technology that allowed her to communicate. And so what she had was, she had a friend with her who has a keypad. So as I'm speaking, the friend types into the keypad. Harbin has a keypad, a braille keypad, which is connected to that. And so every time the friend types, little sort of inserts on Harbin's keypad go up. And so she touches it with braille. There is maybe a 30-second interruption between my question and her answer. We carried on a 1.5-hour conversation. So you could choose truly to bring all sorts of abilities into your workplace. And there are many ways to enable that, of which technology is one, but intent is the most important.
Absolutely.
Yeah. What would you like to say to that?
I would just endorse, you know, what Ira and you yourself have said and Rajeev have said. I think this is a business imperative today. And I think the world is opening up, India is opening up, all our organizations. I mean, like Ira talked about, you know, the different kinds of leads that we are providing, the different kind of opportunities that we are providing, the different kind of technology systems we are providing internally within the organizations is truly, truly inclusive. And today, you know, we've launched something in addition. So we're calling, we are actually bringing in maternity, women who've undergone maternity, they're coming back and they're kind of, you know, easing them in into the business. We call it a charisma program. And why do we call it charisma? Because it actually creates a charisma for them. That's one of the core areas where we are losing a lot of workforce who otherwise would have wanted to be a part of the active workforce. Mm-hmm. And now they are. They have the opportunity to do so.
Yeah, if I may have your permission. Rosabeth Moss Cantor, who's a professor, most of you probably would have heard or read her also. She wrote a book called Super Corp. And her main thesis was that the really powerful and successful corporations of tomorrow would be those which have very intense interaction with the communities that they operate in. And her logic was the following. When you interact with communities, you get information about the unmet needs of underserved customers in underpenetrated markets. And out of that knowledge, you can create products, services, target segment, market segments, as well as whole new business models. Because you're solving real big problems. And that's what business actually will finally make money in and do good also at the same time by solving human problems. Not only that, community interaction becomes a crucible experience for leadership development. Because when you interact with communities, you have to learn how to influence without having formal authority. And that is going to be the leadership model in all corporations.
Yeah.
A leader will no longer cannot be the old command and control type. I have all the answers. You know what I tell you. You know, I grew up with that kind of a thing. That was the role model there. Mm-hmm. Now it won't work. So I'm just reinforcing that there's a lot of research coming out for the naysayers and the skeptics that actually we have enough evidence to show that doing good and being a good businessman are not opposed. In fact, they have to go together.
Yeah.
I'm sorry for
I think a very, very good point you raised. I would also like to know from you. So you were conditioned in this outlook that command and control. And now you have adapted yourself, it seems, to this more, more liberal attitude, where you also know that tomorrow you will have to handle a person who is not only reporting to you or who is not only working for your company, but is working for 5 more companies as an employee or part-time employee. So how have you brought about this change? Has there been an epiphany that you have been able to change suddenly, or this has been a gradual exposure to thoughts which were quite different from those in which you were schooled?
Do I have your permission to be very truthful?
Absolutely, go ahead.
Okay, and I may take a minute or two. So I have never subscribed to the command and control theory of leadership. I have had a lot of trouble right through my career, except in the last 15-20 years. You know, I appeared and joined a service called the TAS, the Tata Administrative Service, 1975. I went through 1 week of interviews, and at the end of it, the member secretary of the TAS committee, good old Dinsha Maligamwala, came to me and said, "You know, Dubey, we have a problem." And I said, "What is it?" He said, "We are very impressed by you, but we think you're a Naxalite." So I always was built that way, and I really struggled because I could see that it was nonsense. How can one person have all the answers? How can somebody not listen? How can you really lead a team unless you are respecting? So I was struggling with it all the time, and thank God that somewhere around the late 80s, 90s, actually there was a book called From Good to Great, and I think that was, you see, unfortunately we need something to come out from Harvard or Princeton to start believing in it. You know, we don't have enough confidence in our own self. So that happened, and then the whole paradigm started shifting. So frankly, since you asked me a personal question, I did not have an epiphany. If I had any epiphanies, they were of a very nasty kind, where I was punished for thinking this way. But I have great joy that now I work for an organization and I'm now in an era where people are seeing that this makes really good business sense.
Okay.
Being a good human being, listening, not pretending to have all the answers, having no shame in saying, "I don't know, I'm unsure," you know, not being 6 feet 4 inches tall and having blue eyes and blonde hair to be a good leader. Thank God those beliefs are breaking down.
No, that's fantastic. And let me tell you just one sentence about Rajeev. Rajeev is not only the CHRO of Mahindra Group, but also he runs two large companies as the where the CEOs report to him. And so he brings that perspective also. Coming back to our last set of questions, and I'll open the house after that. You have done data mining, and that will become more and more necessary as tasks are jobs are broken into tasks, some to substitute, some to augment, some to replace. So how has been the experience so far in terms of cooperation from the employees who you are, let me say, monitoring to support and enrich, etc.? What's your view? Who would like to answer this question?
Would you like me to take it? Okay. So I think I would start even before we have employees. I would go back to, let's say, people who are aspirant in coming into our organizations. So, you know, and I'm going to go back to talking a little bit about IBM in this. At IBM, we have a tool which actually gives an aspirant, a candidate who's an aspirant, the opportunity to find your fit. So you can actually go to a bot, you can talk to that bot, you can do an assessment and find your own fit. Do you fit into the role that, you know, you think you're fitting into? Is there an opportunity in the organization where you can fit in? And what are your key skills or key attributes which are going to take you where? So that's a pre-candidate kind of a offering that we are now providing to people. In addition to that, there is, you know, once a person is within the organization, then there is the actual recruiting part of it, which is your Watson candidate assistant. It actually helps you through the entire life cycle of recruitment, complete life cycle of recruitment. So starting from, you know, when you are meeting up with the organization, you found your fit, to how you're going through the interview, how you're going through the interviews, and how you are actually leveraging technology at every stage as you go along.
Okay.
To the extent that you're also onboarding people, the employees, through a tool itself. It's a cognitive onboarding tool that you're bringing in. So I think it's becoming predominant now. But at this point in time, it is limited to a few organizations. I do think that, you know, there is opportunity to spread this further.
You want to come in, Rajeev?
Yeah, I want to come in. You're allowing me to be the contrarian today. So I'm I'm told that in the latest issue of the Harvard Business Review, Peter Capelli of Wharton has actually raised a lot of doubts about how good really these IT and AI tools are for recruitment. Okay, so I'm just,
yes.
Now let me just say one thing, they must be done, by the way, we use a lot of it. But look, if we only start taking in people who fit beautifully, you know, don't we run the danger of having groupthink? What would be the role of somebody who's truly innovative but doesn't fit and is rejected by a machine?
Rajeev, I'll just come in there. The tool is for a candidate to find his own fitment, to do his self-assessment. It doesn't go into IDN. You find out about yourself. So it's an offering for the person who wants to apply. It's not being applied within the organization.
Oh, but a lot, we use tools for recruitment, don't we?
So it's a combination.
We outsource actually recruitment. We outsource on. Oh, no, you don't.
I'm yes, saying we do not.
Many people do.
Yes.
And I think there one has to be a little careful.
I mean, I would be really very careful about that because, you know, recruitment is not just, and bringing in people into your organization is not just about the technological essence or knowing what skills and what learnings the person brings and, you know, what is the experience that the person brings, but what is the cultural fit? What are the other angles that fit into the overall persona of that organization is very important. So I think it's got to be a combination of it.
Also, I feel that some level of attitudinal compatibility between the aspirant who's applying
and
the organization
culture.
Is related. Also, just to add something here, what is Capelli's take on the table? He's a professor.
Yeah.
Which businessman is saying that? And that will really bring us, but I accept your point and I'm not read that article. I really appreciate that. That is keeping the energy going. So last question, how do we attract and develop the new talent we need as well as ensure our existing people do not get left behind? Ira, how do you do that?
Attract and retain, you attract people today.
Attract and develop new talent.
You attract talent in the most sort of wide, diverse way possible. You know, with the assumption that everybody can learn. So I think that's really important today, right? Because the skills which are going to work tomorrow is not technical skills you have today. It's the ability to unlearn and relearn. It's creative skills, it's cognitive skills, it's social skills, it's emotional skills. Because automation is going to take care over a period of time over a lot of the technical function of these, right? And so I think the way to attract talent is to be as inclusive as possible. It's to not only look for a one-size-fits-all, sort of this is the kind of person with this skill set. There are companies which buy other companies just for skills, right? There's that happening today. You buy another organization, not because you want their product, but because you want their people and their skill set. So I don't think there is, I think you do it like that. You have to use technology in order to cast a wide net. So technology really helps. Tools like LinkedIn are developing all sorts of cognitive sort of backends, right, to make sure that your searches are as effective as possible. So you use technology as well. But I know that Rajeev wants to say something.
Yeah. Also, just to focus this question, there are organizations which are using technology, they are also influencing educational curriculum. They are interacting at the level where people are still in their educational institutes to make them faster ready and lessen the lead time required to be an employee when they join them. From that point, I'm coming. Would you like to have a go at that? And then I'll come to you, Rajeev.
Yeah, so I think, you know, the net is going wider and wider. Today, we are curating what skills we need from the market, from the educational institutions. Not only that, we're going to the basics. You know, for example, we're sitting in Haryana. We've tied up with the Haryana Vishwakarma Skills University. We've tied up with organizations like, what we call PTEC as a program. We are talking about people from the grassroots, just imbibing the right skills and then bringing them on board. So I think the net is really widening. You don't, no longer need to have that curriculum of being a graduate followed, or a, you know, technology engineering graduate followed by an MTech and followed by probably, you know, some fancy degree from somewhere. There is a job. You need to be skilled enough to be able to deploy that. And there are different levels of what an individual would be doing. So the, you know, what is the minimum delightful skill level that the person possesses and that you hire him or her for that?
Rajeev.
So let me sort of try and put a cat among the pigeons, but at a slightly different, so I'm defocusing a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
Your question was a very good question. How do you attract, develop and retain? Yeah. That's what I heard.
Exactly.
And I'd like to suggest that maybe the time is coming when we have to rethink the talent model, and it becomes how do we access, how do we curate, and how do we then engage with the people who we have accessed and curated.
Interesting.
So the attract, retain, attract, develop and retain, given the changes that we are seeing in work, workforce and workplace, may have to give way to a model which is based on access, curate and engage. So
and
may
I just that. Add to that, you know, we've got to do this right at a very early stage. So it starts from basic schooling. It starts, it goes on to maybe, you know, leveraging the polytechnics and leveraging the skills universities, etc. So I think it's got to go very deep down now.
Just give us in two sentences, what is ISA and MICA and what is the conceptual thought behind these so that others also in the audience can use it in their own companies, so, on their small ways.
So ISA is really, you know, how you, everything today in today's world is getting augmented with artificial intelligence, right? So this ISA is a program and it's a tool which really helps you in understanding how to leverage AI in your current work. How do you use it for your customers? And you make sure that your customers also can get the benefit and delight out of that. So that is what is ISA all about. And I'll give a small example. In yesteryears, we had, let's say, you know, service delivery as a main mainstay, right, of our businesses. From service delivery, we went on to, let's say, maintenance services. From maintenance services, one went on to transformation. And today, one is moving on to, you know, automation and cloud and, you know, AI and IoTs of the world, right? So with all those changes happening, how can you transform and change yourself? And how can you leverage these technologies? How can you apply them for your clients? The second part which you talked about is MICA, right? MICA is a cognitive nudge. It is really, a cognitive nudge means it gives you a talent alert in a way. This is about my career. So how do I pave my career? What are the kind of skills and learnings that I need to pave my career for what is going to be the future tomorrow in our organization and in the ecosystem that we are surviving in? So to enable that, we have yet another platform, which is called Your Learning. Yesterday, we would typically, you know, just go onto an intranet and try and find out what should I skill myself on, what should I learn. But today, the tool called Your Learning actually picks up what is it that you are, your entire background, your inferred skills, what you bring to the table, your current role, your past roles, it kind of builds on that, your performance, it builds on that and it curates a full-fledged learning platform for you. And MICA picks that up and tells you how can you progress your career, what next?
Great. So let me open the discussion to the audience. Any questions, comments, please feel free. Yeah, there's a question there.
So we've been talking about skills, a lot about skills. At the same time, this workforce is also the new workforce is also very restless. So time spent in a role is limited before they get bored and they want to try something else. Are we turning into training institute? Because there is just the time when a person learns a skill, delivers on a job. But a lot of challenge that we're getting in our workforce is that I'm bored. 6 months into the role, I'm bored. 3 months into the role, I'm bored. What's your view on that?
So what's your view? Ira?
I think we turning into training institutes is difficult because it's a very big we, you know. I think some companies have always been poaching grounds for other companies, and I don't think that's going to change. What might happen is transition cycles might become faster, correct? But I think this whole, and I've said this in many different ways to many people, Generation Z is very different from Millennials, is very different from X, is very different from Y, is not necessarily a philosophy I subscribe to. I think we just, as we become old and gray and get white hair, we forget what it was like to be new in the workforce. We would have been restless too, correct? It's just that the numbers of young people who are joining the workforce today is so much that they are bringing in a wave of restlessness, whereas the numbers which were joining earlier were fewer. So I don't really think it's a huge shift. So as I said, I'm an optimist and I'm a very moderate person in my point of view. So I don't think there's very much to worry about. I think you've got to be able to understand in any organization that different people have different needs. They have different aspirations. They have different learning paths. And you've got to be able to curate. I love that. I'm going to take that and steal it.
I stole it from somewhere.
Excellent. Access, curate, and engage. I'm going to take that. But you've got to be able to, that's what organizations have to do now. You've got to be able to curate engagement and learning so that everybody feels that there is meaning and purpose for them.
So also to add to that, it is said that earlier our life was learn, do, retire. Now it is learn, do, rest. So in fact, one of the greatest thinkers in this, he says that earlier your work life was building a home, deep foundations, and then, you know, that was your education. Now it will be like a foldable tent. So again and again, you will encounter such people who are restless. And perhaps one way is to keep them engaged through upgrading your own levels of skills and what you are imparting. And the other way is to keep the funnel through which people enter wide and let the radar, let the searchlight swing rigorously on that area from where people come in so that you get the best from there. Any other question?
I'd like to just add one point.
Go ahead. Sorry.
I think it's also a little bit about understanding what their aspirations are and then trying to, you know, map them against what is available in terms of the roles that are available, in terms of what kind of skills they can imbibe, how they can learn, and what is it that they want to do. So I think it's a little bit of mutual mentoring, if you will, some amount of reverse mentoring that's required over there. And that could possibly be a little more helpful.
That's a very valuable suggestion. Go ahead, please. Shikant, I'm coming to you, sir.
So Rajeev, since you were forthright and took contrarian views, I'm going to take some liberties with you. A lot of the discussion today was focused on quality of the workforce and not quantity, which is the problem we started with, not enough jobs being created. So here comes the curveball. Notwithstanding all the hype around make in India, manufacturing creates only 0.83 jobs per crore of capital deployed. The number for Mahindra is 0.73. Apollo hospitals create 7, Blue Dart creates 14. Do we need more Blue Darts and Apollo hospitals rather than manufacturing to solve the problem of numbers?
Sorry. So, my answer is that you have to have supply and demand match. So I think there's huge scope for more hospitals, there's huge scope for more services. I think inevitably services as a proportion of the GDP will keep increasing, but you certainly have to have some base of manufacturing also. We will still need food to eat, right? We will still need water to drink. Despite all the platforms that we create, there will still be physical goods and services that will need to be transacted. So certainly the services sector will have to grow. That is where you get a much better return on capital employed or much better return on employment generated. But you can't afford to totally neglect the manufacturing. That's the answer I would give, because you have to match supply and demand. Imagine an economy which had no manufacturing. Yes, you could say they could import, but if every economy thought this way, then the equation would start tilting. And they, so I think finally you have to have that equilibrium. But clearly manufacturing is not the panacea for all ills by any stretch of the imagination. Now, how much stretch should you, how much emphasis should you put? What percentage should it be of your GDP? What should be the growth rate? The fact that we skipped a whole sort of phase of economic development with mature economies went through because we actually transited from a very low manufacturing base, largely agriculture, into a phase where agriculture got replaced by services largely and manufacturing continued to be very small. So I think that's the answer I would give.
Just to add to
I don't
that,
I guess that was clear as mud.
Allow me to add to that. When the farms was when agrarian during the agrarian economy, when the industrial revolution came, 90% of the population on farms in 100 years moved to industry. That means only 10% of the farmers could now feed the entire world. Similarly, from 1950 to 2010, 75% of the factory employees moved to service industry. So service industry, as you said, is surely one of the areas where we'll get business, or where we'll get employment. And also, Srikanth, I feel that 54% of the millennials, like the ones you are leading, have started a business or about to start one. So that will also be a big employment boost, which we will get through them. Your question, sir? We'll take one more question after that and then we'll close. Yeah, yours.
Yeah, hi, good evening everyone. My name is Anshuman Dixit. This is a quick question and I take a very, very micro view of what has been discussed. And I'm also, like Ria said, being a confirmed optimist. The fact remains that whilst we have talked about the future of workforce and Rajeev talked about HR and tech connect and interaction, how are we going to ensure that the future generation of employees when they join, what are the kind of behaviors or the soft skills that they are going to demonstrate that will make them more future ready? And what efforts are being taken in that direction? Because just let me take one moment. One side we have these schools about the top 50 and then the 5,000 that are there, the tier 2 and the up to whatever level, that focus on getting more of engineers, you know, 50-60% or 70% are engineers, less of the social sciences or the humanities background. And the same people, once they pass out, there's enough money spent to build up their behavioral skills so that they can contribute effectively to the workforce. And on the other side, we have lesser professors coming in from the industry. Very few these schools talk about professors of practice, it's only the PhD that is focused on. So, where are we headed and how do we create that behavioral change and behavioral skill mindset in the bunch of students who are passing out and the current group of employees? What is the future?
Rajeev,
me?
Yeah.
Okay, so I completely, in fact, if you, I don't know, I can hardly expect you to remember all the rubbish that I said here, but my main thesis was that the role of the so-called soft skills, the behavior, the connections that people make, values, culture, that has to become even more important with the advent of technology. And therefore, we have to be very careful that the people that are coming out are not only left-brained nerds, but also have right-brain qualities. So you need people who can do whole-brain thinking, because the fact of life, and I know that I'm expecting 38 people to jump on me when I say this. Frankly, business is all about philosophy. And one of the core requirements of a CEO has always been and will be more so as we go forward to be a philosopher. So I see actually the role of the liberal arts, the role of soft skills, the importance of culture, of behavior to become very, very important. Now, it's not that the other hard skills are not, I'm not saying that at all. I'm just saying that you need both and we need to actually start paying far more attention to behavior, values, ethics, collaboration, philosophy, poetry, because the pressure would be more AI, more machine learning, more analytics, more robotics, more hard stuff. But till human beings remain beings that have the fundamental need to connect, to relate, to feel recognized, to feel that they are contributing something. Till that remains, we will need a lot of your skills. Now, if one day human beings themselves morph and become machines, I don't know. I mean, I'm told there's some theory about that. Then I don't know. But for the foreseeable future, I think what you have said is very critical, and it's at our own peril that we will ignore it as a nation or as an organization.
That was an excellent answer. Last question, please.
I'd like to just add
one more.
I think another one or two points that we should also be cognitive of is entrepreneurship. So I think, you know, individuals turning entrepreneurial in their aptitude, I think that's very important, and having that innovative streak. So just complementing what you said.
Wow, very good. You would like to add something? Okay, go ahead. Last question, please.
Continuing the discussion that's going on, logistics technology and how it's impacting a lot of lives today. So, considering the personalization with respect to technology and how one is actually reaching out to talent and their market, and but what they considering all these all the companies and working in the similar spaces. So, what about adding value through technology, and also adding the aspect wherein the startups are also being a part of the whole ecosystem? Because if it's an MNC, they can actually consider the costs that are involved with AI and technology and the personalization that's involved. But what about the startups and the ecosystem that today in India, as you were talking about entrepreneurship and business, and a lot of people are actually doing that venture. So what about that, considering the cost and the customer acquisition part?
Who would you like your question to be addressed?
Anybody, because
go ahead, Rachna.
I am a generalist, poet, philosopher, Naxalite. I can't answer that question. It has to be these ladies.
Go ahead.
So I think the very concept of startup starts with being digital natives in a way, right? So AI and cognitive and all kinds of technological innovation, I think, is pretty inbuilt in almost every startup that we talk about. So while it may be a grassroots startup, or it could be a high technology and startup, I think it's inbuilt internally into. So there's no dispute in terms of that being a intrinsic part of any kind of a startup, right? I think what you're probably talking about is how do you sustain it going forward, right? Because there are constraints in terms of resources, there are constraints in terms of financials, there are constraints in terms of getting the right kind of strategic business direction. I think that is what probably is a concern area and is probably on one's mind when one is talking about the startups. I would actually move it to people like Pavan, who actually have and Siddharth, who have the blue circle to kind of support you through that.
Great. Okay. Okay, last quick question, please, sir.
I come from a different background. I am a doctor. And one thing which I wanted to bring up is the humankind today, the biggest disease we have is loneliness. 56% of people feel lonely. With all technology which we are developing, how much more it's going to grow, and where are we leading it to? So with what I have personally felt, and I guess most of us have experienced, how much our kids talk to each other? Or how much they even talk to us? They just talk to machines. My iPhone, my iPad, my TV. So where are we going with all AI, cognitive and machine learning? Where is it going to lead? It's actually going to be more depressing times in years to come, because nobody's going to talk to each other.
So would anybody like to answer, or this should be the topic for the next discussion, because this is a very valid point. It's a very valid point. The jobs are becoming soul deadening already. And as I said, the biggest, the most popular synonym for boss is zookeeper or slave driver. So I think we'll come to your questions, sir, perhaps separately. There are two more hands going up. Quick. One minute, please, Ronesh, and then you, sir. That's it. Yeah.
Thank you for that thought.
Compliments to all three of you. Lively discussion. My question is twofold. Number one, with the advent of technology, you see jobs getting delayed, organizations getting redesigned. And what would be the new job that you think would be in key demand? And secondly, do you see with the advent of technology, say the kind of CEO or CHRO that organization would need to change? And if so, what would be some of the key dimensions of that?
So I think, Rajeev, everybody wants you, I think, to have the last word. Oh. Finish it now. Ronesh's question and his comment.
So Ronesh, let me sort of again stick my neck out. So there will be a requirement of skills, but you're not talking about the technical skills. I that's the feeling I get. Here is my view. I think we need people who have the ability to use both left and right brain, who can use the whole mind. We need people who can be multipliers of energy, passion, engagement, creating a sense of ownership, which really means that they listen. They're not the extreme command and control type, right? Then we need people who know how to manage fear and leverage the learnings from failure. We need people who are open to all the possibilities that exist in a situation by not being prisoners of their own past, either success or failure. And finally, above all, I think we need people who can create trust through authenticity. So if I were to look for a person, sure, there would be certain technical skills, because I think there would still be jobs which would require, say, IT knowledge or accounting knowledge or whatever. But I would definitely look to see whether they have these traits or characteristics and will display these behaviors, which will have then to be combined with the technical skills to produce organizations that are innovative, where the potential is unleashed to succeed in the new normal, which is VUCA plus this pushback that we talked about. It's a bit of a canned answer. Sorry for that.
I think that closes the can for in terms of this discussion. Let us close it now and please continue your discussion with the panelists.
Wow.
And thank you very much. What an honor, what solid questions and very fine answers and interventions. Thank you very much.
Wow. What an enriching discussion. Thank you so much, panelists, and thank you so much, distinguished audience, for being here today. I'm deeply honored to have you here today. And As part of our CEO Perspective Roundtable series, we're hosting another roundtable on the 30th of April on the anatomy and adoption of smart manufacturing on 30th of April. So people interested may reach out to me. And as a token of our gratitude, I would like to share something with our panelists as well. So thank you, everyone. Now, I would request you to join us for wine and food, please. Thank you so much.